Hey, what is up, players? It's Warboss Tay up in his mug. Today, we're going to be painting this Wood Elf Glade Guard. I thought it would take 2 or 3 videos to actually get through, but I'm really happy that I was able to get through it in one. I have kind of approached this as a batch painter wood because I've been going at it, trying to get this whole battalion of Wood Elves painted up. I think the method I found is really great, really effective at painting Wood Elves up. And I'm not doing too much work, but still coming up with a great finished product that you can build up or scale down as you wish. Going over the colors, I've got Mournfang Brown, Kislev Flesh, Caliban Green, Elysium Green, Rakarth Flesh, Steel Legion Drab, Warpstone Glow, and now I'm all caught up, Moot Green, Xandri Dust. We're gonna make our Wood Elf here blonde, but you can do a variety of different hair colors for him or her. Waha Flesh, Rhinox Hide for the dark brown leathers, Doombo Brown, and that's it. I don't know if I went over the shades. Did I go over the shades? The two shades that I use are Raglan Flesh Shade for the skin. Sorry, oh, this is gonna be one of those videos that get kind of blurry. The camera wants to focus on the paint pots in the background. It doesn't know where to look, so my apologies. There might be some blurry bits to the video, unfortunately. Raglan Flesh Shade, which I realized that I did not paint on these lovely exposed elbows. Seraphim Sepia for the hair as well as for the bow. That's pretty much it. So to begin with, I started by painting the entire model with Mournfang Brown. This was after I built it. I glued it together, I let it dry, I based it, and then I primed the model in gray, and then I don't think I primed this in gray. I think I actually had a Mournfang Brown primer. So I wanted to give it a try. I like how it covered, and I think if I was gonna do more of these Wood Elves, I would definitely use it again, because the brown is a good color for, it's a good like middle color. It's not as dark as Rhinox Hide, so you're not building up bright colors from a very dark undercoat, and it's not, you know, green like any of her clothes or her cloaks or her leggings. So the first thing I thought when I was coming up with a paint scheme, was I wanted to do a summer-themed Wood Elf commission for this commission. I wanted a unifying theme to be the season of summer, because I love the season of summer, and it's a classic bright green Wood Elf color scheme. I remember when I first started painting the Wood Elves back when they came out in the 90s for Warhammer, and everyone wanted to do these bright spring and summer themes. I guess my theme could also be considered spring as well. I've seen some beautiful autumn and winter color schemes that I would like to try my hand at, but for now I'm just showing you how to do the summer color scheme. And my thought is that when you go to a forest and you look around, you see all these different shades of green and brown. And they're not just variations on the same tone, but as you can see, I painted the little hanging loincloth there Castellan green. And that is a much different green from the Dark Angel's green, or the Caliban green, that I had just painted on the leggings as well as the cloak. So we're going to go for 3 distinct green colors. You've got your base of Caliban green, your base of Castellan green, and in a little while, we're gonna use Waha Flesh to base our bright, vibrant green tone. This Rhinox Hide, though, is gonna kind of anchor our model. I wanted to not immediately get fully invested into all the green colors, but I wanted to paint the boots, the gloves, the shoulder pads. If you look at any of the art for the Wood Elves, especially now that they've got Wood Elves in Warhammer Total War, for the PC, I think that's such a great opportunity for gamers to see their see their models come to life. If you need inspiration, I think seeing the digitized versions of your miniatures on the screen is a great way to do that. I remember when Space Marine came out, Dawn of War, obviously, seeing your miniatures in video game form for the first time. Oh, so much fun. So like I said, we're painting Rhinox hide onto the boots, and you kind of go all the way up. I think some of the models have like knee pads. Anything that's not legging or the upper, if you see on the upper thigh, there's some bands that loop around the upper leg. We're gonna paint those in Mournfang brown, but we're also painting in Rhinox hide the shoulder pads, which I think happen to be dark brown leaves, as well as the gauntlets, the forearm protecting armor. Now, when we're looking at our wah flesh, I wanted to balance out all the Caliban green. So because Caliban green is going to be my cloak color, I wanted to see that brighter, vibrant green. We'll call it that moot green, that warpstone glow, bright, colorful green. I wanted to balance out that dark Caliban green. So I'm thinking of, you know, the dark treetops, the moss, and just all the different colors of the leaves, which you're also going to see in the Dryad tutorial, which will be coming out later in the next couple of days. The funny thing was, I was working on this model and I was thinking, like, what are some strategies where I could paint this model for a tutorial, but also paint the Dryad and the Glade Rider, because I'm doing this commission where I'm painting an entire Wood Elf battalion and I want to do all three of them at the same time. So I really loaded up my memory card with video files, painting all three of these, just going back and forth. So you might notice when a clip will cut, the paint will be still wet and shiny. And then when it comes back, it'll have dried because I went on to paint the Dryads and the Glade Guard, and just going back and forth. That's how you do it. If you have an army that you can really knock out, you want to go back and forth between the units so that your models have some time to dry. Of course, that wouldn't be a problem if I was painting an entire unit of these guys, because I would just assembly line them, boom, 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 one after the other. And by the time I was finished with the last guy, coming back to the first one would mean that their paint would pretty much be dried by then. Sometimes I don't like to assembly line that way, though. I mean, you know, it's always up to you, the painter. Okay, so just to kind of review what I did with my Wa flesh, there's some little hangy sleeve bits. There's also the tunic that I painted in Wa flesh, and the skirt. So in Mournfang brown, what I'm doing is I'm painting the little flaps that hang over their hips, as well as the kind of rope banding around the torso. And I'm also eventually going to be getting to those bands kind of looping around the upper legs, but we'll come back to that. Rackarth flesh, I thinned it down too much, and it's going to be really, really wet and overflowing, and it's going to get onto her hand. And don't follow what I did. I guess listen, do what I say, not what I do. And when you're dipping your paintbrush into the Rackarth flesh and you're, I guess, spreading it out on your palette, your wet palette, you want to make sure that your brush is not overloaded. That's a classic sign of overloading your brush. If you look at the top of her hand, it is almost completely drowned in that Rackarth flesh color, which is okay because we haven't painted it yet, but it's always better to address those problems before they crop up. At this point, I'm looking at the model and I'm thinking, all right, I want to get some skin tones on it. So I'm taking that Kislev flesh, which is a beautiful pale, very kind of fair skin tone. And normally I wouldn't want to start with Kislev flesh. I remember when it was called Elf flesh back in the old color range, it was too thin to use as a base color. But because we started with Mournfang brown, which is this rich, deep brown, painting up, building up the color to this pale skin tone is actually okay. It's actually even going to be closer to Rackarth flesh, which is why I'm kind of sopping up the paint there and kind of getting it off the hand, because I want to paint the hand in Kislev flesh, and actually having a little thin layer of Rackarth flesh underneath is, it's not going to be the end of the world. So because I'm a perfectionist. I'm looking at the model to see if there's anything else that needs to be painted in Rhinox hide, and I realize that that's what I am going to be painting my arrow shafts. It's a my kind of method of painting is to balance out the colors on a model. So you never have a color just out of nowhere unless there's a reason for the eye to be drawn to it. In this case, I'm looking at the Doombull Brown. And the Doombull Brown is this dark reddish brown color that we're going to use for the arrow shafts, the feathers, and up at the top. And the reason why we're not using Doombull Brown anywhere else is because we want the eye to notice it. And when you've got a model like this Glade Guard that wants to be camouflaged, that wants to kind of just disappear into the surrounding forest, you want there to not be too many crazy colors popping out of it. And that's why I thought Doombull Brown would be great for the feathered shafts of the arrows, but nothing else. I'm not even going to use it for her lipstick, which I've used Doombull Brown for my Spellsinger lipstick, and that was very, very effective. So I'm taking my Steel Legion Drab now, and I'm just lightening the color on the quiver. And it's okay if you get any of that onto the leaves wrapping around the quiver, because those leaves are going to be repainted in just a second. So I'm taking my Kislev Flesh, and what I'm doing is I'm not painting the leggings or the legs. Some people paint the flesh tones on the legs, but then it makes it look like the elves are just wearing skirts. And some of the guys, or the models, I wanted to... Well, when I was looking at the model, I wanted to make the skin tones only evident in the arms and the face. I thought if it was kind of like if you're looking at a star, imagine a star where the points of the star are the head or the face, and then the arms and the hands, and then the legs. I think it makes it a more tighter composition of colors if the skin tones are only in, if we take that star and we turn it into like a triangle. And then we see the hands, the arms, and the face. And then our eyes are not really drawn to the legs as much, if that makes any sense. It doesn't have anything to do with men wearing skirts and why he shouldn't be covering up his legs in green leggings. So like I said, I decided to make our girl blonde here. And there are two ways that you could do it. You could either do it with XV88 as your base color and then build it up to the blonde. Or you could just go straight in with Xandri Dust. And Xandri Dust is the perfect blonde hair color if you're doing, if you're bulk painting your troops and you want to get a quick blonde, then it's the easiest, a quick dye job. The easiest way to get that effect is Xandri Dust, shade it with Seraphim Sepia. And if you want, you can do a little highlighting, but you don't even need to. Once you've got that shade on, that Seraphim Sepia, it's going to naturally create that depth of blonde hair. And who wouldn't want a beautiful blonde elf maiden to paint? I think that's terrific. I've also done the hair dark with Rhinox Hide. I've also done it in a light brown color with Steel Legion Drab. And of course, you could just keep that Mournfang brown color if you want as well. It's really up to you. There's the great thing about painting humanoid models is that you can really go to town with the different shades of hair color, skin tone, all of that. Our diversity makes us beautiful. I don't know what I'm trying to say. I'm sorry if you can hear my dogs barking downstairs. They're playing. They're going crazy. And I'm sorry. It's a little baby termagants running around down there, chewing up all the furniture. I think the lady boss is down there playing fetch with them or something. They usually don't get this excited unless they're like chasing something around the house. With the Mournfang Brown, I'm looking at painting the reddish brown areas that I want to be a little bit different from the dark brown of the rhinox hide. So I'm creating this kind of leather material with the mournfang brown, and so I'm really kind of isolating, like, where is that going to be? So the like I mentioned before, the wrapping around the torso, the little hip flaps, and I think just now I painted some of the leaves wrapping around the chest and around the right shoulder and the left arm. Going back in with some rackarth flesh. If I'm just cleaning up a color, I might not mention it, and you might even see if I'm not able to really paint it in time, I might go away and paint it off camera, but I'll always mention it. What I'm doing now is I'm taking my rackarth flesh and I'm painting in the little detail, the little ties of the rope, like cord-like material that wrap around her torso, because they almost seem like a little zipper coming up the top. So why not? Oh my gosh, that dog. Kislev flesh, again, I've given the hand some time to dry and kind of wiped off as much of that rackarth flesh as I'm going to get. And then I'm just very, very simply touching the model's fingers with it, getting some of that Kislev flesh onto the fingers. Okay, I don't know where I was. I actually had to stop recording, and okay, Warpstone Glow. Yeah, dogs are going nuts downstairs. So building up the colors, a lot of painting is repainting and finding what works for you. What I tried to do at first was just paint Warpstone Glow on, because I thought, oh, here's a great bright green. It's gonna be perfect. It's just cartoony enough while still being able to look like, I guess, semi-quasi-realistic. My goal with the Wood Elves was I wanted them to look fantastical and magical, but I wanted to ground them with a little bit of realism in the way that I painted their skin tones and the way I did the highlights and everything. So because it's so blurry, I apologize. I'm going to just kind of talk about my theory and hopefully my dumb self in the past when I recorded this will look up at the viewport and realize I'm not even in frame. When I was coming up with the concept for the army or this commission, I had a couple things in mind that I wanted to achieve. And I think I was able to accomplish those tasks with my Glade Guard and my Glade Riders, as well as my Spellsinger, which I think was a great success. And it's funny because I wanted to achieve a kind of cartoonish, whimsical, colorful, fantastical look while also maintaining the realism of having a realistically painted skin tone and doing some realistic looking highlights. So my approach was that I was going to use the brush strokes when I'm highlighting to really emphasize the lines, and the way that I'm using the brush strokes is as I'm building up the colors, first with Warpstone Glow and then with Moot Green, I'm being very conscious of the direction that I'm painting my colors on. The tricky thing is that when you're painting a model that has so much of one color, you want to be consistent with the direction that you're using your paint strokes. So I'm always kind of dragging down and almost like at a diagonal, so that my paint strokes are never just straight up and down, nor are they just across left or right. They're always kind of at a little bit of a diagonal, so that they kind of look like when you're looking at the model head on, that they have almost like a cascading waterfall effect. And that's something that I thought was effective for something like cloth. It's not going to be as effective if I was doing like a power armored space marine, for example, or if I was painting, you know, a tank. That kind of diagonal brushstroked highlighted color scheme is not something that would be as effective. The thing that makes it work for these models is that the material is very flowy. I wanted the cloth and the leaves and everything to have a very soft but sturdy look to them. And I think I achieved that pretty well. My next highlight color that I'm going to be using is this Elysium Green, and I'm going to be painting it onto the Caliban Green areas. The reason that I'm going with Elysium Green and not something like a Warpstone Glow is because I've got my Warpstone Glow Moot Green, and I wanted something that looked a little bit more drab, but also have a very good color tone to it. And so Elysium Green almost looks a little yellowish green, like a mustardy yellow green when you're painting it on. And it contrasts really nicely with the bright, like almost neon radioactive yellow of the Moot Green. As you can see, the Elysium Green really looks nice when it's feathered on over a darker green color. I think Elysium Green actually picks up really, really nicely. The trick is that you want to give it enough time to dry before you add on the successive highlights. It creates a very stark highlight when you're going from the very dark and rich Caliban Green to this kind of brighter Elysium Green. And like I said before, it really captures the essence of what I wanted to do with the Wood Elf color scheme, which was to create a mixture of different shades and color tones. I made a little bit of a mistake here. I should have actually painted the loincloth in, I should have highlighted that Castellan Green in Lauren Forest. And I didn't realize it till after, but I think I just go back over it with Elysium Green. I kind of mix it up with the other Caliban Greens, but yeah, you actually get a third green tone when you do that. So I think it's effective to do, but I wanted to not do as much of that color as the Moot Green and the Elysium Green highlighted colors, which is why you only see that loincloth in the center, as it has that as an accent. I'm doing the Raiklin Flesh Shade now on the skin. And it's a little tricky to do because Raiklin Flesh Shade is a very rich reddish tone. And it really brings the skin to life. It gives it a very nice tan and a little bit of a realism by kind of creating different depths to the skin. You don't want to go too much because when it dries, it's going to pool and it's going to look really red. And you don't want to do too little bit either. You want just enough to create some good depth to your skin tones. I'm using sepia on the bow, Seraphim Sepia. I'm also using Seraphim Sepia on the blonde hair, because it really brings out that yellowish blonde colors, and it's a shade that is a little bit more yellow than the reddish brown of the Raiklin Flesh Shade. So when it dries, it's going to create a really beautiful contrast. You're going to see the hair, the blonde hair, the skin, and the bow, all various shades of yellowish blonde to ivory to kind of that pale skin color. Here's where I do it. Here's where I mess up. I'm like, oh yeah, just go. I didn't highlight the loincloth here, so I'll just go back over that. It should be Lauren Forest. Lauren Forest creates an interesting third green color, like I said. I think at this point it's like 3 o'clock in the morning, and I'm really just trying to get this thing done. I hope you guys are doing well out there. Man, I'm really motivated to kick off the year and do some good work with my painting. I'm super, super excited to get it done. So this is pretty much it. It looks like how I showed you in the beginning of the video. There are some areas that I could highlight if I wasn't just batch painting these guys, if I wanted to go and bump up my war boss level to like a war master level. But I think for a good tabletop standard, this wood elf looks just fine. Hey, thanks for watching, everybody. You can support me by clicking on the links below, and we'll see you in the next video. Latest players!